Hello students, myself Mrs. Supriya Save. I'll take your chemistry paper 2. Now in chemistry paper 2, there are two chapters, solid state and catalysis. So very first we'll start with solid state. As you know, there are three states of matter, that is solid, liquid and gaseous state. So in this chapter we are going to discuss the details of the solid state. Solid possesses definite volume and definite shape. So in this respect they differ from liquid and gaseous phase. As we know, gas doesn't possess a definite volume and definite shape, while liquid possesses definite volume but not a definite shape, while solid possesses both, that is definite volume and definite shape. Now whenever we are going to discuss about the solids, solids are mainly of two types, that is crystalline solids and amorphous solids. Crystalline solids and amorphous solids. So what is it mean by crystalline and what is mean by amorphous, that you knows because it is included in your syllabus since from your school. So crystalline solids have a definite geometrical shape with flat faces and sharp edges. They possess sharp melting point, and generally crystalline solids dissolves in water. So this we can consider as a characteristics of the crystalline solids. Well, whenever you are going to compare the amorphous, at that time amorphous solids do not have definite shape as well as as I have told you, amorphous solids are the solids which do not have definite geometrical shape. They don't have the sharp melting point. So generally liquids and gases shows the transitional motion of atoms or ions. So in case of crystal ions or atoms, in case of crystals, ions or atoms moves at you can say that mean position, while in case of amorphous solids they have intermediates between the solids and liquids. So many times whenever we are going to consider the amorphous solids, we are considering that they are the supercooled liquids. What happens in crystalline solids? In crystalline solids, if atoms or ions are present, then they don't leave their space. They have, you can say that, definite geometrical shape. And if there are the vibrations, then they vibrate at their mean position. While in case of liquids, atoms or ions, they show the translational motion. While in case of amorphous, they are in between the solids and liquids. So hence they are also known as a supercooled liquids. So for this, best example is your glass. Glass is always considered as a supercooled liquid because it's not a crystalline. As well as one more thing related to amorphous solid is, always they melt gradually. That means they don't have sharp melting point. They gradually melt means they melts at the range of temperature. Okay. So in this chapter, we are going to discuss in details of the solids as well as mainly for the crystalline solid. So whenever we are going to discuss about the crystalline solid, at that time always we remember the scientist Bragg, scientist W.H. Bragg and his son W.L. Bragg showed that crystals could act as a grating for x-rays, and hence the structure of crystal can be determined by the x-ray diffraction method. So we are going to discuss the details of that, but directly going on that, very first we'll discuss little about the why they are known as crystals, what are the laws and everything. So very first we'll start with the crystallography. Crystallography is a branch of science which deals with the geometry, properties and structure of crystals, as well as structure of crystalline substances. I'll repeat it, listen carefully. Crystallography is a branch of science which deals with geometry, properties and structure of crystals and crystalline substances. Now we'll discuss about the laws of crystallography. Laws of crystallography. So there are mainly, we are going to discuss three laws of crystallography. So first law is known as a first law of crystallography. First law of crystallography, or it is also known as law of constancy, or it is also known as a law of interfacial angles. Law of interfacial angles. So first law of crystallography is known as first law of crystallography, or law of constancy, or law of interfacial angles. According to this law, the shape and size of crystal of certain compound or element may vary with the conditions under which crystallization occurs, but the angles between the corresponding faces are always constant. Again, I'll repeat, listen carefully. According to this law, the shape and size of crystals of certain compound or element may vary with the conditions under which crystallization occurs, but the angle between the corresponding faces are always constant. Okay. Now here the term faces is referred to the surfaces which are usually planar and binds the crystal, and the angle between the two interfacing faces is the interfacial angle. So related to this, I'll show you one diagram. Here I have shown the crystal of the same element. Under the different conditions of crystallization, they take the different shape. Okay. Though I have shown you the hexagonal, but there may be some different shapes. But you can see that though the shapes are different, the angle between the faces is same. That is theta, theta, theta. So therefore this law is known as law of constancy, as angle remains constant, or also known as a law of interfacial angles. Now for this, I'll share one example which is related to the NaCl, common salt. Now this NaCl crystallizes in cubic form in the water, that is in aqueous solution. But that is NaCl crystallizes in cubic form, okay, in aqueous solution. But it crystallizes out in octahedral form if that aqueous solution contains urea. Okay, so it takes octahedral shape in aqueous solution containing urea, while it takes a tree-like shape. It takes a tree-like shape if some amount of gum arabic is present in the aqueous solution. Okay, so NaCl in different conditions take different shapes, but the interfacial angle is same in all cases. That is, interfacial angle remains same. So this is known as a law of crystallography, first law of crystallography, or law of constancy, or law of interfacial angles. Now we'll discuss about the second law, which is known as a law of rationality of indices. Law of rationality of indices. Okay. This law of rational indices was first stated by the French mineralogist whose name is R.J. Hawk in 1782. So this law states that it is possible to choose the three coordinate axes, unit distances, which may or may not be same length, such that the ratio of three interfaces, intercepts at any plane in crystal is given by the ratio MA S to NB S to PC, where M, N and P are the integral numbers. Okay, where M, N and P are the integral numbers. Again, I'll repeat. Listen carefully. It is possible to choose the three coordinate axes, which is X, Y and Z, I have shown. It is possible to choose the three coordinate axes, unit distances, which may or may not be same length, such that the ratio of three intercepts of any plane in crystal is given by MA S to NB S to PC, where M, N and P are the integral numbers. So in other words, we can say that all faces cut a given axis at a distance from the origin, which bears a simple ratio to one another. So for this, I'll show you again one diagram. Now in this diagram, you can see that these are the three axes, X, Y and Z axis. This three axis origin is given as O. Now here we have considered that there is a plane of crystal, say ABC. Suppose if this plane ABC intersects the three axes along the distances a, small b, small c. Okay. And one more plane is there, that is D, E, F. D, E, F. Now this D, E, F will intersect the three axes X, Y and Z along the intercepts 2A, 2B and 3C. Okay. 2A, 2B and 3C. okay. Then ratio of intercept is given as 2:2:3, which is known as a Weiss indices of the plane. These are known as Weiss indices of the plane. Now what happens if any one plane is parallel to any one of the axes? That means here what happens? The plane ABC intersects all three axes, X, Y, Z, and intersecting distance is given by small a, small b, small c. Same way, the plane D, E, and F intersects the all three axes, X, Y, and Z. They intersect at the distances 2a, 2b, and 3c. So their ratio is given as 2:2:3, which is known as a Weiss indices. But what happens? Suppose we'll consider the plane. Now, this is a plane. This plane will intersect to the x-axis only. It will not intersect to y and z axis. Or suppose if I consider such type of plane which will intersect with x and z axis only, or x and y axis only, or y and z axis. That means any single plane you can consider, okay, which is parallel to any one of the axes, then it becomes difficult to present the ratio by using Weiss indices. So in such cases, the another ratio is used, which is known as a Miller indices. Now, what is this Miller indices? You have to take reciprocal of the Weiss indices and then multiply that reciprocal with the LCM to get the interfacial values. Okay, so suppose we'll consider the plane DEF. If we want to present it by using Weiss indices, it can be presented as in the ratio of 2:2:3. But if suppose I don't want to present it by using the Weiss indices, if I want to present it by using Miller indices, then what I have to do? Very first, I have to take reciprocal of this Weiss indices. So reciprocal of Weiss indices is given as 1/2, 1/2, and 1/3. Then you have to find out the LCM of this 2, 2 and 3. So LCM of this 2, 2 and 3 is a 6. So multiply this reciprocal by the LCM. So LCM is 6. So 1/2 multiplied by 6. 1/2 multiplied by 6. And 1/3 multiplied by 6. So 2 3s are 6. 2 3s are 6. And 3 2s are 6. So what you will get the answer? You will get the answer as 3:2:3:2. You will get the answer as 3:2:3:2. And this is known as the Miller indices. So the plane DEF is designated as 3:3:2 plane by using the Miller indices. So this is about the law of rational indices. Now in next lecture, we'll discuss about the law of symmetry. Thank you.